thoughts are just racing along. And each sense, if I go like that, you will respond quickly. Now, can you imagine arriving at a place where your thoughts, like waves on an ocean, get calmer and calmer and calmer, where the senses fall away until finally you are here, and I am here. We are beyond space, beyond time. We are in infinity. We are in eternal time.
I looked a lot different when I was a behavioral scientist doing psychological research. I was also teaching, doing therapy, and writing books at that time. In 1961, I started research with Tim Leary into the psychedelics. Politically, working with these chemicals was difficult. There was much publicity, and we did develop a degree of notoriety from our work. But we proceeded nevertheless, for these experiences touched our inner life in a way that psychology had never done. Through them, I touched a place inside myself that had been up to that moment covered over. It was a place behind all my social roles, even behind my own body or life or death. It was like pure eternal consciousness. But even after 300 more psychedelic experiences, I still could only remain in these very high states of consciousness for brief periods. I kept coming down. The psychedelics had definitely shown me the possibility of higher consciousness, but I kept coming down. Achieve higher states of consciousness. Singing and dancing utilize the emotions as a vehicle for helping the individual to enter into higher states of consciousness. By opening one's heart to a higher being, such as is done in Hinduism through the repetitive chanting of the name of various incarnations of God, such as Krishna and Ram, the devotee is able to ultimately merge with God. In the Muslim religion, the whirling dervishes, known as Sufis, use the dance, along with the praising of Allah, their name for God, in a similar fashion.
Allahu, Allahu, Allahu.
Both singing and dancing are forms of what is called Bhakti Yoga, the Yoga of Love. Meher Baba, an Indian Sufi, has said, and I quote, "Love has to spring spontaneously from within, and it is in no way amenable to any form of inner or outer force. Love and coercion can never go together. But though love cannot be forced on anyone, it can be awakened in him through love itself. Love is essentially self-communicative. Those who do not have it catch it from those who have it. True love is unconquerable and irresistible, and it goes on gathering power and spreading itself until eventually it transforms everyone whom it touches." A very different method, though still a part of yoga, is the calming of the mind by sitting down before a candle. Just hanging out with a candle. Not trying, just letting the thoughts go by and keeping the attention directed towards the candle. After a while, one's thoughts become noticeable as a passing, continuous stream of almost random associations. What am I doing here? My leg hurts. I'm hungry. I'll never get enlightened this way, and so on. At this point, one is staggered by the profusion and racing nature of one's thoughts. Vivekananda has said that the mind in this stage is like a drunken monkey, or one can think of it as a turbulent ocean. With such a confusion of thoughts, the deeper aspects of one's being, just as the depths of the water, are lost from view and one totally identifies with each thought. As meditation proceeds, the meditator very slowly learns to let the thoughts go by and stay in an inner place. This is the beginning of the breaking of the identification with thought. After a while, the thoughts become both less frequent and less intense, and the ocean of the mind calms. Then one begins to get a glimpse of the depths within. Finally, after one is totally free from attachment to one's thoughts, the mind has become calm, and its depth, in all its profundity and light, comes into view. Now one finds one's own self-luminous nature. Great sun, but you do not see me. I am your husband, but you turn away. I am the captive, but you do not free me. I am the captain, you will not obey. I am the truth, but you will not believe me. I am that city where you will not stay. I am your wife, your child, but you will leave me. I am that God to whom you will not pray. I am your counsel, but you do not hear me. I am your lover, whom you will betray. I am the victor, but you do not cheer me. I am the holy dove that you will slay. I am your life, but if you will not name me, seal up your soul with tears and never blame me.